With regard to the Pope, there were inconsistencies of the same kind, and as inexplicable, there's no doubt that he had keenly desired the coming of the Pope to Paris, that he had employed every kind of promise to bring about his journey. His subordinates have emphasized and exaggerated his words, but he had spoken them. He was not the man to allow such notes as Talleyrand's to be sent off without having corrected them, or to receive such letters as those of Fesch without reading them. Whatever entered the Foreign Office went straight to his cabinet. He knew everything, and his subordinates did not venture to make amplifications without his orders. Then he had wished for the Pope and entered into engagements with him, of which, if he had strictly kept those appertaining merely to form and etiquette, he would have been able to infringe the rest that he did carry out and fulfill. It seemed as though he took a sort of vanity in affronting in his court the Pope whom he had brought thither, that he endeavored to lower, humiliate, and put him in an inferior position on every occasion. He, the host, took the precedence of his guest. He gave him entertainments which the slightest sense of decorum would have forbidden. He made him, the Pope, dine with his family like a citizen entertaining his vicar. He gave him horses for his return into Italy and mapped out the route which he was to follow in such a way as to prevent him arriving in a large town at the time of the Easter festival. It seemed as though he were jesting at the expense of the Pope, yet he loved him all the same and thought that he had won him over, which was perhaps true since he had asked the Pope to crown him. It was doubtless because he held him to be the representative of the highest religious authority. Accordingly, to heighten the influence of the consecration, he should have placed the Pope, who conferred it above all mankind, have made him a messenger of God expressly descended from the seven hills, so much more. He should have lavished honors upon him and surrounded him with respect and adoration. All this would have been politic and, without making any precedent, could have been carried out at the court beyond the sight of the populace and would have given an opportunity, under pretext of preserving his dignity, to prevent too frequent a contact between the Pope and his faithful. He thought nothing of this. Supposed stay. Bored and wearied him, and he showed it. It offended his pride to give the Pope precedence, so he took it himself. He demanded his presence whether he had need of him or not. Never for a moment had he a sense of what he owed him as emperor, nor when he had received the consecration from him of what he owed him as a believer. And yet the consecration was valid only if he were a Catholic. Bad education and want of breeding? Perhaps. Yet he knew well enough, if necessary, women caprice more than likely, partly at least, with other members of his family. This tendency was clear and far more distinct. The characteristic meanness and incivility, the unconquerable aversion to being bored, the aptness to suddenly break off a scheme, and the impossibility of self-restraint. With him, there was less of this, yet in certain tragic epics of his history, does not something show itself, something which is excused and explained, but which in reality springs from that same kind of nature and disposition? And at the same time, he expected much from the Pope, whom he thus treated like a glass, which is broken after being emptied. He hoped for a number of future honors. I was astonished that they were refused to him, that his desires were not anticipated, and that he was shunned and opposed. Ah, strange man. The more he is studied and examined, the more numerous become the problems. Is it not that when search is made for profound reasons and thought out designs, it is often necessary to be satisfied with the workings of an impulsive temperament swayed by affection, anger, and ill humor, of which mingle spontaneous and unguarded actions with weighed and reasoned resolutions? Perhaps this is even one of the most fascinating sides of his genius, and not the least instructive. Only how to sit apart, recognize these acts. In a few cases, some certainty can be attained, but more often in the moment of concluding and forming an opinion, you hesitate and correct yourself. In that kind of history which endeavors to lay bare causes and looks upon facts as material for the investigation of certain personalities, there is is continual searching, frequent error, and uncertain success, but at least it is ennobled by the study of such a man, and becomes, once its deceptive delights are tasted, the sole obsession of a writer thirsting for the truth. Frederic Masson, December 2nd, 1907. Coronation of Napoleon and his consecration by the Pope. Chapter 1, from Toulon to Notre Dame, the route followed. Early in June 1793, an artillery captain arrived in Marseille from Corsica. He was a thin, hungry-looking little man who had lately become a French citizen in expectation of the advantages to be obtained by assuming that nationality in his own country. He had received such a check to his ambitions as had forced him to turn them in a more promising direction, for he had excited envy by his youth, offense by his presumption, and suspicion by his earlier career. Overestimating his own strength, he had hoped to carry all before him by sheer audacity. But everywhere he had met with opponents subtler, warier, and more powerful than himself, a crowning folly on the part of one of his brothers had forced him to leave the country and cross over into France, which he found plunged in the middle of a civil war. It was doubtful which side he would take, for it was uncertain which party would prove victorious, Paris or the provinces, the Montagnards or the Girondins. The former party, who were the extremists, had subdued France to their intolerable tyranny and were setting up amidst the growing confusion of government, so impossible that its members, wholly at variance among themselves, began cutting each other's throats even before their power had been thoroughly consolidated. The Girondins had assumed the policy of moderation, but when in power, they had themselves promoted by their unscrupulous greed and rancor those very measures against the results of which they were now in arms. They had favored the Parisian party, and though thinking themselves its leaders, had been really guided by it, they had trumped up false accusations against the ministers who had preceded them. They had cheapened the prestige of authority and begun the religious persecutions. They had smoothed the way.